HOTEP community, welcome back to the Philippe Matthews Show Live. Thank you so much for tuning in with us and being back with us again. We hope that wherever you are safe and that you are sound. Today's show is very close, near and dear to my heart. The people that you see with me are also very close and near and dear to my heart. A brother that I worked with some years ago, as a matter of fact, Walter Smith. He is known as the Street Soldier. He is out of, I believe, Cincinnati, Ohio. This guy is literally a force of nature. When I met with him, I don't even remember how we met, but I just remember falling in love with this cat and his story and his mission and message to the community and what he was doing. I wasn't Reverend Shock at the time. I didn't have hundreds of thousands of viewers and all of that at the time. I was still on, if you will, my come up. But we rocked with this brother, and his story is absolutely amazing. And he reached out to me recently after the George Floyd verdict, or the Derek Chauvin verdict, if you will. And he says, Philippe, I have a unique perspective on this because I've been on the other side. I had to lay down for a minute, and I really have a unique perspective that I want to bring to the community. And I said, brother, anytime you want to come on, you can. And so we decided to have him on with, of course, back with us again is Brother Keith Staten, who is my attorney. So when I get ready to F up a white person, that's the guy I'm going to call. Back with us again is Brother Greg West, Felons with the Future. So we've got Walter Smith, the Street Soldier, Greg West, Felons with the Future, and Keith Staten of Keith J. Staten Law. Gentlemen, welcome to the program.
HOTEP, thank you for having me, Ray.
Now, okay, let's get it started. Now, I'm going to start with you, Brother Walter, because this is all your fault. This show is dedicated to you. You started all of this, reaching out to me, and I thought it was genius what you came to me with. But also, I labeled the show Racial Socialization, How to Survive an Encounter with Law Enforcement, because, as you know, I've had Dr. Howard C. Stevenson, who we call our racial socialization sensei, on, and I shared my story during the Amy Geiger situation of how I racially socialize when I encounter law enforcement. But I've encountered it as a civilian, not as a felon or former felon. You have, and you have a unique perspective on this that I think the community needs to know, because, as you know, Michelle Alexander, author of The New Jim Crow, shared with us and educated us that there are more felons on the outside than the inside. And so there is about 7.5 million of us walking around with a label on our neck, and it's a control mechanism. So with that being said, Brother Street Soldier, can you tell us a little bit about your story, how you came to be, how we started rocking, and what you're doing right now?
Thank you so much, Brother Philippe. And I want to go back, and I am out of Columbus, Ohio, but I tuned into one of your shows when I was speaking actively about 8-10 years ago, probably, when you interviewed Dr. Joy DeGruy Leary, post-traumatic slave syndrome. I caught that. I was in a hotel room. And right after you finished that interview, I called you, and the rest is history. You did an in-depth interview with me about 6 years ago, and another piece soon after that. But one of the main reasons that I reached out to you, my brother, as candid as I can say, and you brothers jump in and help me out as we go, I made bad choices growing up in life. I come from a well-to-do background. Both parents were in the home. I'm not one of those that pointed my parents, like I've witnessed so many brothers, and say how dysfunctional the home was, because I think most homes have some degree or component of dysfunctionalism in them. I think that at a certain age, you should be accountable for your own actions. And one of the things that I learned in prison when I went back over to the continent, over to Ethiopia, and start studying, I learned that males in certain parts of East Africa, they go through a rites of passage at age 8. They have to leave the home, go out, chase what they're going to eat, catch it, kill it, and eat it, if that's the kind of game that they had an obligation to feed the family. Whether it was fishing, hunting, whatever it was, at age 8. So having said all of that, any decisions I think that we make after age 8, I don't think that we should blanketly blame our parents. We need some degree of rites of passage. So that rites of passage for me, irrespective of my parents' shortcoming, I had a lovely dad and mother in the home. Alcoholism played into that a little bit. But I remember my parents when there was no alcohol. And that was before the age of 8. And those are the things that I hold on to. So I started smoking cigarettes at around 12. I started with marijuana around 14, a little cocaine. By the time I graduated out of high school, I was already selling up to a quarter pound, a half a pound of marijuana back in the 70s. Mm-hmm. By the time I got 25, I'm now pushing 25 pounds of marijuana a week and 5 pounds of cocaine a week. So finally, I got addicted to cocaine during the same time that Richard Pryor went through the freebasing thing. And if any of you remember, someone asked him in stand-up comedy, "Well, Rich, how did you blow yourself up?" And he said, "Well, I took the cookie and put it, instead of putting it into the milk, I put it, you know." So what it was is you take the tweezers with the alcohol, you put it in alcohol, you hit the candle, you hit the pipe. Rich forgot to blow the fire out and put the alcohol back into, put the fire into the alcohol, and that's how it blew up. And a lot of people don't even know that story.
Right.
So all
right.
That being said,
you remember the joke that people would light a match and say, "What's that?" "That's Richard Pryor running down the street."
Exactly. That was the joke. That was the joke. Right. Because he took that and burned himself up, and he did. Yeah. He got up and ran because he was on fire. And that's the joke that a lot of people had. So for me, I couldn't get drug treatment, man. I had gone through a $100,000 cocaine addiction. I had done real good in the business. And now black people can't get into selling marijuana. Because my business was marijuana. It was when I started messing with the cocaine. Couldn't get no help. Tried to get help. So now I can't get treatment. Matter of fact, I called the treatment people. They said, "Well, Mr. Smith, they asked me, well, do you have any money?" I said, "I don't have any money." "Well, do you have a drug problem?" "Yes, I do." "Well, how much is your habit a day?" $500 a day. "Well, Mr. Smith, if you quit getting high for 10 days, guess how much money you'd have?" "Bitch, if I could quit getting high for 10 days to pay you the $5,000, I wouldn't be on the phone with you." Okay. So after that, I couldn't get no help. I just keep robbing people until I got caught.
If you're watching, watch with your parents or just, you know, caveat emptor. This is a real show. Okay.
This is real life stuff here, man. Right. Crazy. I decided that I was just going to rob people until I got caught or killed. And this is what we are doing the show for. Finally, when the last robbery that I did, and I had done several, I'm strung out on cocaine. I had gotten a pistol from the robbery before that, and I don't know anything about pistols, so I took the clip out. I walk in and say, "This is a stick-up. Ain't no clip in the gun." So that's the first sign for the guy. Ain't no clip. He said, "I'm not giving you no money." "Well, I'm coked out. I don't know nothing about this," right? So I turned around and left because he didn't give me no money. And then watch this, Brother Philippe. That was the one I said, "I can't do this no more." Now, keep in mind, I had been hitting them up pretty good. Mm-hmm. And I parked too far away. And the best thing that happened in my life, brothers, I almost made it back to the company car that I was driving because I was selling brand new cars. Mm. And a police officer had his lights out. Now, watch this. I'm teaching. When you do robberies, you know you don't hear sirens. I tell you what you do here. You hear all them engines racing and you hear that helicopter because they coming to get you. And this is my message and why we're doing this whole show, because I know I done already said I can't do this no more. But I almost made it to the car. But that one officer saw me with his lights out. And that spotlight hit me because he kind of knew where I was at. He looking for me and he got me. I get in the car to pull out in a brand new car. Now he slides up, jump out with the ride gun. And here come all these other cars. You hear them coming. And now the helicopter's up top. Put your hands on the steering wheel. You move one muscle, nigga, I'll blow your brains out. George Floyd or a lot of my other brothers. Mm-hmm. Hands on steering wheel. Now, I had already been raised to know that if you run from the police, they will kill you.
Right.
So then they came, all of them now. It's about six of them. Nigga, get down on the ground. One had his foot on my ankle. One had his foot on my wrist. And one had his foot on my neck. The one that caught me had that ride gun up against my head. It's July 17th. It's hot. My head on the other side is against the asphalt. And he's shaking like a leaf. "You move one muscle, I blow your brains out." And I laid there. I thought I was suicidal from the cocaine because I had been. I had a .357 up to my head. I couldn't pull the trigger. My dog wouldn't let me. Spell dog backwards, what do you come up with? Because in the dog's eyes, he's looking at me like, "Come on, man, you ain't going out like that, is you?" And I took the gun down. So I thought I was suicidal until a cop had that gun on my head. Then they told me to get on my knees and put my hands behind my head, and I kept laying there. Did you hear what we said? Look at the arms on this nigga. Get on your knees and put your hands behind your head. Officer, sir, you just told me if I move one muscle, you was gonna blow my brains out. George Floyd's not here today to take care of his mother, which had passed before him. I took care of my mother the last 6 years of her life. Oh. Don't nobody interview me because I'm breathing and I'm a successful retired professional bodybuilder, run a business. I take care of my family extremely well because I laid on the ground. I didn't say nothing. And as a former felon, that's why we're having this show. Because brothers, if you know you wrong, especially if you know you did wrong, lay your ass down and shut up. Don't do the crime. Don't do the time. Don't do the crime if you can't do the time. Because when you get caught, lay your butt down so you can get out of prison, come out and take care of your mother before she dies, and you don't drive her crazy like me and my brothers did my mother.
My, my, my. Well, that's how you start a show out. That's a, that's called the opening segment, family. Thank you for that, Brother Walter, for sharing that. That's why we are here. Thank We're going to take a deeper dive into that. Brother Greg, Keith, I'm going to come to you last because I want to come to Brother Greg, have him share his story with us as well, and then we can move forward on in this conversation. Brother Greg West, Felons with the Future, talk to me about what happened to you.
Well, you know, a lot of my story mirrors a lot of Walter's story. You know, I came up like what we talk about is good stock and everything. And I too don't blame, you know, my mother and my father for what they were doing. They were doing now with the healing that I've done and the work I've done on myself. I know they were doing the best that they could, the best they knew with what they were working with. You know what I mean? And I happen to be one of the first generation of crack dealers. You know, I got into the game because, you know, like I remember, you know, growing up and my mom, you know, at the time my parents were divorced and she's doing everything she can to keep the family together, you know, going to work on the outside. It appears that we got it going, you know, she's a middle class, a pink collar worker, you know what I mean? Cause she's working in corporate America as a financial advisor and all the other good stuff. But on the inside of the house, bills are barely getting paid because, you know, you know, we got to keep the stove open and stuff like that to stay warm in the winter. And some of the stuff that you know, a lot of us have done. And around the age of 14, you know, crack ended up in my community. And I've gone, you know, I went from, you know, wearing hand-me-downs and wondering what we're going to really eat today and watching mom struggle from, you know, doing that in one summer to, you know, being able to, you know, pay bills, you know, wear name brand shoes and all of that stuff. And I found that, you know, like my addiction took off in the form of the hustle and everything. Yeah, I used every day of my life, you know, alcohol and marijuana and everything. And I never thought that it was really affecting me. But the real thing that it was is I was addicted to the lifestyle because, you know, coming from barely making it and then, you know, having all of this stuff that you never had and the fear of going back to where you coming from. Kick my addiction in high level where, you know, I was doing all of that. And like, you know, it was up and down. I tried many different avenues to get out the streets, went to the service, ended up over in the Gulf War, you know what I'm saying? Came home, tried, you know, the religious aspect, say, I'm going to change my life. I'm going to church. That didn't work. I ended up, you know, selling crack with a Bible in the car and all of that stuff, man, you know, and it just progressed and it progressed till, you know, eventually, you know, I ended up catching my first drug case in 97. You know, I got caught with, you know, and, you know, back then, the truth and sentencing laws, if you got caught with 3 grams of crack, you were going to jail for 3 years, you know, stuff like that. And I one day I was drunk and forgot I had dope on me and everything, and arguing with the clerk at the store because she wouldn't sell me no more alcohol. She goes call the police on me. I tell her, bitch, I got a phone too. I call the police on myself. That's how I ended up with my first drug case. You know, crazy. Wow. You know what I'm saying?
Wow. Crazy.
You know what I mean? Forget that I had these drugs on me and everything because I'm drunk out of my mind. My ex-wife, you know, when they come to get me for public intox and everything like that, my ex-wife at the time was with me. And I see her go in my pockets and she pulls out her hands holding it like this with all the money out of both pockets. So I'm thinking, okay, if I got any product on me, she got it too. So, you know, the arrogance of the street, you know, the street hustler, you know, like, hey, I'll be out talking to Tony Montana. I'll be out before you get off your shift and all that. Get downtown and they go in my pockets and they find three grams. And I'm like, oh, wow. You know, I'm like, they done planted this on me and everything. But the lawyer I had at the time, you know, he told me, listen, you get you a job, we'll get you probation. We'll get a reduce from the F3 that it is down to F4, F5, get you probation and all of that. As it turned out, I went ahead and got into, you know, I got a job eventually, got in a trade that I'm in now that I've been in for the last 25 years. And
good for you, man.
But it still didn't stop me, you know, because like I said, that lifestyle, man, watching that money coming in, watching that money. And, you know, every time I tried to exit away from the game, you know, I was still addicted to that lifestyle and the money. And I went back on another, you know, a long run. And, you know, by this time, my thinking is like I'm above the law because, you know, here it is. I paid for this case to be done because he said, like he said, he told me, you know, we get you a job, we get you and you make a donation to this judge's, you know, reelection fraud, you know, you know. So basically, you know, I paid my way out of that case.
Right.
So from 97 until 2008. I never really, you know, I will have run-ins with the law, but I never got it, you know, another drug case. Then in 2008, by that time, we had advanced to, you know, instead of driving the coke and the heroin up and down the highway, we were shipping it UPS, federal, you know, using the you know, statute of limitations up for me, so I don't care. You know, we were using the postmaster and all of that, sending it back and forth like that. And March 20th of 2008, I got caught at the post office trying to get a half a kilo in the mail. And I remember, you know, my defective thinking at the time was I was still always want to blame everybody for it. Because I remember when I got caught, my co-defendant, when I got my discovery pack, he had already had a 3-page statement written out. Talking about if I could remember where he took me to drop these other boxes off, I would tell you where they were at, you know, and I'm like, this dude, you know. But what I didn't realize is I was being rescued, but I still didn't stop after doing, after my plea bargain. I only did 2 years, no good time, all of that stuff. I came home and I was back doing the same thing. You know, 11, like 9 months and 3 days after being home from the penitentiary, I got raided again. And, you know, it was still the same vicious cycle, you know, the same vicious cycle, the thinking. I hadn't, you know, but one thing did happen. Let me back up. While I was locked up at Pickaway Correctional Institution here in Ohio, I started picking up books and started reading because I was one of those ones who read a lot as a kid. But now I started doing it. That's when my consciousness started growing. And that's where I devised the ideal of felons with a future, because I was looking back at my life like, you look, you come from good stock. You've been in honors classes. You got all the stuff that you had going on all your life. How did you find yourself here? How could you keep yourself from coming back? And that's where I came up with the, you know, the idea of felons with a future. Like, maybe if I take these, you know, because most of the people I did crimes with, we were nothing but illegitimate businessmen. To run a drug business is, people don't know, that's a real business you're running. You have to understand about your inventory. You got to understand about marketing. You got to understand about location. You got to understand. I mean, there's a whole bunch of stuff you have to do.
But supply, we were doing demand, the whole nine, absolutely.
Right. We were doing it illegitimate. So I said, maybe if I can teach these young men and women how to become business owners legitimately, we might stay out. And I thought about it. I came up with the business plan. I wrote all this stuff. I'm talking about, I wrote all of this in 2009, but I didn't implement it until last year, as you know, Philippe, you know what I'm saying? Because I had to go through what I had to go through. I came home, I got locked back up for another 6 months for, you know, weapons under disability. And that's when May 21st of 2011 is when I surrendered. I put my hands up. I said, I can't keep doing this. And the best thing that happened was that last raid. When they raided us, there was only one person's name on the search warrant, and it wasn't mine. And they caught the brother there. They let him go and took me to jail. And I said, oh, no, I can't keep doing this, because, you know, they just blatantly shown us we rock with the CIs before we will, because, you know, ain't no way I should have been going to jail. You know, he should have been going to jail even though he was a CI or whatever, just to play the front, you know. And I said, the game did change, you know what I'm saying? So I started working on changing my lifestyle and changing my paradigm. And that's where we got to this point where last year we started the program in July of 2020. We just graduated our first class a couple months ago. We're starting our second class coming up. And what we do with Felons with a Future is we're teaching young men, restore citizens and returning citizens, how to become entrepreneur and businessmen, how to work on their paradigm, how to work on that healing of the trauma. Because, you know, like as you, anybody who knows, like Walter, you know, from being on this side and on the other side, you didn't just wake up one day and say, I'm going to commit robberies. You didn't wake up one day and say, I just didn't wake up one day and say, I'm going to start selling weed. There was something, there was some sort of trauma that led us all to it. It might have been a fear of, you know, not having enough. It might have been a fear of what was ever going on. We didn't want to live like that. So what we work on is working on healing from the trauma that sent us to the streets from the first place. Then we also get them, try to get these men and women to, you know, feel comfortable enough to talk about that trauma. Then we work on the trauma that we experience while we're in the streets. You know, every time you watch on the movies, you always see it a luxury lifestyle. They don't talk about, you know, like what you were talking about, people like you. I didn't want to see coming. If you was robbing, I didn't want to see you. So I had to protect myself with a whole bunch of, you know what I'm saying, goons that even though they were loyal and loved me, I know on the drop of the dime, they'll turn on me too. So there was a lot of fear, a lot of drama. I mean, a lot of trauma going on with that, you know, in the lifestyle. Then, you know, dealing with the police and all of that. Then the trauma that you go through once you're incarcerated. You know, then a set of trauma that you go through once you're returning back to society and trying to learn how to navigate and trying to live a normal life with this tag on you, and also not trying to go back to the lifestyle, but this is the only thing you know. So mm-hmm. we work on that while we teach them how to do a business plan, a marketing plan, how to implement, you know what I'm saying, branding and all of that stuff. So these are the things that we do, and that's how I got here, man. And like I say, like you, if it wasn't for the police rescuing me on March 20th of 2008, I wouldn't be here now. You know, I wanted to black people for so many years, you know what I'm saying, about my lifestyle and all that. But like Philippe say all the time, man, I had to get with it. Nothing's wrong with me. Something happened to me. And I started being able to work on what happened to me to get me to this point. You know,
yes. Good stuff, brother. God bless you, man.
God bless you. Thank absolutely. Ashe.
Ashe.
Brother Keith, yes. You heard the stories.
Yes.
We're going to get even deeper into diving. I know you have to go. You're on a time schedule. So we're not. So if Keith just ups and disappears, it ain't because he don't like us. It's because he actually had to go. But the time that you're here, brother, I want you to hear the you heard the story.
Yeah.
And particularly with Brother Walter Smith, when he said, get your ass on the ground, nigga, don't you move.
Yes.
When talk to us about, in terms of racial socialization, because many of us think we would say, you know, fuck you, you can't talk to me like that. Who the fuck you think you are? Bang, bang, and you're done. Talk to us about the power of racial socialization, doing what the cop says so you can come home. What how, your thoughts on that from the attorney side of it?
And I'll explain.
Because after he got to go home, he called what he called somebody like you. That's what he did.
Yeah, absolutely.
Let me tell you, it's a pleasure being with you, because what I learned is that we all have our stories, you know, and we all have our path and stuff, and there are always similarities between them. Me, I was going in the wrong path, and my sisters diverted me. They put me in a Catholic high school at ninth grade without my parents even really knowing about it. That was how they, because they heard, they saw what I was doing, and they like, we got to divert him. And that's and they did that. And I didn't know a lot of that until much later.
Look back, they saw it.
Who were behind that. Now, it put me, I played sports. So I didn't want to drop out, but I had to go. It was literally an all white Catholic high school. I'd never been with white people before, because this is 1972. And right after the integration thing, and we grew up military brat, we still stayed with the black people and stuff. So they did that, and it shocked me, because I felt like I couldn't even go back to my neighborhood again, my old homies and everything, because those were the kids we used to beat up on the bus, you know, who went to that school. But I wanted to play sports, so I didn't want to drop out of school, so I just endured. But little did I know, it actually changed my life. You know, I tried to slip back into stuff again later once I got to junior college. Baseball wasn't doing it. I'd slip back to the street again. But something else would happen, and I drew back to education. And that's what really, really saved me. There was a couple of guys who looked at me in JC classes and said, you could be somebody. Mm-hmm. And it turned everything around. I was the least likely person in my family to get an education, you know, and then go to college and become a lawyer. Mm-hmm. And so I always look at my life as an extreme flip-flop, you know, where I could have been way down there. I wanted to go to prison. I thought that was the way we graduate. Right, I watched brothers come back, get swole and stuff, and I'm like, yeah. I can't wait. And now I think about that, and I'm like, I was insane. I was crazy. So that's what led me to this thing. And today, my whole purpose as a criminal defense lawyer is really to save Black men, women too, anybody that I can. Mm-hmm. But my whole purpose was that. That's what I was dedicated to do coming out of college. I went to law school and I didn't want to go, but I was told to go by a couple of people who we ganged together and said, this is what we're going to do. We're going to change this world. And one brother, he got murdered the first year that I was in private practice, the one who was supposed to be my running mate, my partner. And the other was our professor. And he was on Haight-Ashbury on the corner in San Francisco is where we would have meetings. And he would teach me and him, because this was a white guy, he would teach us about the Panthers, about the movements and things like that. And that's where we got inspiration to go out and do things. So they told me, in order to learn about this world, I need to know who controls it. Who controls it? Lawyers. Mm. Always lawyers. Anywhere you go, it's going to be lawyers. So I used to wonder, well, what do they know? I should know. And that's why I went to law school, is because I figured if I know what they know, I can walk in any place and say, well, I kind of know what the best of your class knows. I know who the best of your company knows. So that's what brought me here. Criminal defense, because that's what I knew.
Mm-hmm.
I was a criminal. I was like,
you know, it's fascinating. Right. I was going to say, it's like, you know, who's better to represent you than the person who was out there in the streets with you?
That's right. And a lot, and so me, I'm different when it comes to criminal law. I'm very real, as he says. I take my games very seriously. I play to win, but I want to save lives. So part of my whole counseling thing is counseling someone who I represent to do exactly change, to learn how to change, to know not to blame the past, like we were saying, you know, and don't blame your circumstance. Just realize that tomorrow's a new day and you got to step out that damn hole. Mm-hmm. So for me right now, I'm on a strange trip that says I need to do the work on the street. Every person, every brother I meet, everybody I meet, I preach a very simple rule, and it is to save lives. And that is, you know, it's bring me back to, they shouldn't have ever gave me that education. You know, because
they should have never let him read that book.
Never let me. Because I go right to the law, because the law is what guides everything in this society. It really does. And so I go to the Constitution to find my strength and my power in what I preach. So I have a simple solution. You say five words when you're encountering law enforcement. Am I free to leave? Mm-hmm. That's it. And I have to explain to people that what that does is that invokes your Fourth Amendment right, because you're not detained until the officers have said you are. That forces them to answer the question of, are you free to go or not? And whether they're coming at you with guns or not, or just saying, hello, man, am I free to leave? Because the Supreme Court says you don't ever have to talk to officers, ever. Mm-hmm. You don't have to help them. You don't have to do anything to them with them in terms of conversation. And when you don't, it's no reason to detain you. So you have to make it clear how we're operating on a communication basis. Am I free to go? If yes, go. If no, you are detained. And I have to explain, well, I didn't have cuffs on me. They didn't have me in the backseat of the car. Doesn't matter. The Fourth Amendment now kicked in right then and there.
Right there.
So they need a reason to detain you at that point. Then the next magic part is, I want my lawyer. That's it. You say nothing else, but I want my lawyer. You don't say, well, should I have a lawyer? Don't I get a lawyer? You don't say that. I want my lawyer.
You don't ask, what did I do? Why am I here?
None of that.
Yeah. You don't do none of that.
Why you pull me over? Stuff like that. I want my lawyer, because they're magical words. Under the Fifth Amendment, when you say that, all questioning must stop.
Now, let me be a devil's advocate. Let me push back. Because here's the thing. I had Matthew Fogg on my show some years ago. He was a former DEA agent. He's the first brother in the world to win a Title VII lawsuit against the DOJ. for racism. He was in charge of the U.S. Marshals. And he told me the story of like, look, here's what we do. We go into the poorest neighborhoods because the poor neighborhoods are the neighborhoods that don't fight back. They can't afford a lawyer or attorney. They don't know their rights. They don't know, they don't have a vocabulary to know what to say and what to do. And they fear us. And so that is the place where we go now. We have gone into white neighborhoods. The white neighborhoods sell more drugs than the black neighborhoods. They use more drugs than the black neighborhoods, but they have lawyers. They have access to judges. They have access to money to fight a case, because when law enforcement goes in, their job is dependent upon winning a case. If they lose a case, they might lose their pension. They might lose the merits. They might lose money. They might lose money for the state. The state could get sued. So there's a tremendous amount of pressure on law enforcement winning. So when you get pulled over and you're poor, you're scared, you're black, you're angry, you're mad as shit that this white race soldier and black race soldiers who have been conformed in the system of the blue is saying, wait a minute, well, who's your lawyer? You can't, you know, why do you need a lawyer? Why won't you comply? Why won't you talk to us? I just got a couple of questions for you. Why can't, so you're not going to cooperate. You're going to keep saying you want a lawyer, but you're not going to cooperate and put all of that pressure and guilt on you, my brother. I have seen this personally happen. Talk to us about what do you do in that situation when they're trying to coerce you, because they already know, as we all do, when you say that, oh, shit, okay, I'm not getting anything out of this. And now they're thinking, I'm about to lose this case. What am I got to do? I got to go good cop, bad cop. I got to bring everybody in and make this dude comply and open his mouth so we can use his words against him.
Here it is. That's why I always quote the Supreme Court case of Florida versus Royer, R-O-Y-E-R, a 1983 case. Because you will find language in that decision that specifically says you don't ever have to talk to police officers, and your failure to do so gives them no reason to detain. Okay? Now, that's why the lawyer thing is a magical thing. The Fifth Amendment is probably the most important one, because what you have to do, even if you don't know what to do, you gotta know, at least say, I want my lawyer. I want my lawyer. Repeat it over and over and over. Because as you're saying that, and especially with the body cams today, as you're saying that, if they question you after that, and you do start saying something as a result, and they don't stop questioning you, then I, as your lawyer, seeing that fact, have an opportunity to get rid of any statements that you made after you declared, I want my lawyer. Mm-hmm. See? And people say, I got to wait for the Miranda rights. No, you don't wait for it. Mm-hmm. Those are things they're giving to you, options to you. You make it unoptionable. I want my lawyer. That's bottom line. I want my lawyer. Now, you're right, Philippe. They're going to say, oh, damn, he's smart. You see, oh, he know what to do. And if they try to tease, if they come at you, the best thing you could do is just shut the hell up at that point and look at them. The best thing to do is just shut up, because then they got to huddle up. They got to go back now and say, well, why did we pull them over? All right, well, we're going to have to make this up. We're going to have to do this. And with body cams and things like that, we are catching them. We're catching them make it up. We're catching them now have to go back and go, well, what did he do? And as a lawyer, when I see those reports, I can tell right away what was going on. And once you assert that and they start talking afterwards and start tricking you into trying to say something, you know, that's when I know, okay, I see what's going on here. And if you have said something after you said you want your lawyer, that can be kept out and not used against you. And that's important, because what they play games now, like, okay, fine. Rest you pretty, bring you downtown, right? You get through booking, you go upstairs. Now they might send somebody up to go talk to you. Mm-hmm. See? Now, is that a different situation? Mm-hmm. Hey, we want to talk to you now? No, it is the same situation. Yeah. You still assert, I want my lawyer. Mm-hmm. And they walk right out the room. And I tell people, watch television. they never want to show people on the first 48 and all those shows who say they want their lawyer because it becomes boring. They say that and they got to go away.
It's the show is over. It's not a show. Show is over.
Right. There's no more questioning to be done. And it's always the tricky ones. You see, who the lawyers who they want to talk about, hey, want some Coke, want some chips, you want this, you want that. And then the person gets nervous. That's why they leave you in the room for so long in the beginning, because they want you to be nervous. They want you to sit there and think to your head. They're looking at you thinking. And if they see you moving and making a lot of movement and doing stuff like that, then they he's on the edge.
Again. Let me push back again, Brother Keith, and go into this. So we've seen this. Let's use this as another 48 hours, and then I'm going to come to Brother Walter on this as well, and then Brother Greg. Okay, so I'm sitting there. I'm detained. I'm sitting there, you know, I'm sitting there for an hour. I'm thinking, oh, shit, you know, my dog was in the car. I got groceries that are spoiling. I got to pick up the kids and from daycare. I just need to say something so I can get the fuck up out of here so I can go ahead on and do what I got to do. That's, of course, the fucked up thinking. And then they're going to come in and say, well, you know, why do you want your lawyer? If you want your lawyer, then we're going to keep you here. And then you're going to miss this and you're going to miss your job and you're going to lose all of this. And so they trick you, because most of the people who they're pulling over have a life and a lifestyle that is time sensitive. They're not doing what we're doing, where we're just making money online and you can keep me in jail for however long. I'm still going to be earning income. Well, most people are not doing that, and they don't have the ability to. So they're terrified. My mom is sick with a stroke. I take care of my mother. So I am going to then talk. And that's what's going to happen. They're going to keep bringing in these people until I break down and talk and elongate the time and wear me down. Am I right about this?
Well, I'm going to say no, because it's all about this. Once you do assert that, it's clear in the law that they cannot question any further. So when they start, if they come in and start needling you with other stuff, what you've got to remember is repite por favor. You have to just keep on saying, I want my lawyer. I want my lawyer. You may be thinking, I got to get home. But believe me, you'll get home faster and easier by continuing to assert your rights, because they have to huddle up. They got to figure out whether or not they got enough to detain, enough probable cause then to arrest. And then when you say nothing, you give them nothing to investigate. You give them nothing.
In that saying nothing, they're going to say, you're being difficult. You're not complying.
Then take me to jail.
You're not going
to
help us. You're not going to help yourself. Right. Mm-hmm. I'm about to get you out of here. This is not what we want. We don't want you here.
That's a lie.
I know you care about your mother. And I don't know your mother, but I got a mother and I care about her, too. And so if I were you and I was with me, with my mother, I would ask and give what the police was asking for so you can go home to your mother. Do you see what I'm doing? You see how the role playing I'm playing here?
Yeah, but they're lying. You got to know anything out their mouth is a lie.
Right.
When they start telling you things like that, it's a lie. And you know what it is? It's good police work. Mm-hmm. It's good police work. That's why it's a lie, but it's a lie. Mm-hmm. You got to know walking in, everything is a lie. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So you don't listen to it. You can't listen to it. You start putting on music and stuff. Anywhere you go somewhere.
I'm assuming to yourself. Yeah, right.
You really do. And dig this. When that's happening, we realize we got cameras up in the corner. So when that happens, if that happens, if they come and talk to you, just look at the camera and say, I told you I want my lawyer. Now, they're caught at that point. They can come back and just say, go here, go there, you know, sign here and that. But that's it. And I'm going to tell you something. Remember, you get arraigned within 48 hours.
48 hours.
Okay. Right. So if you can't bail out once they book you and set a bail, you are going to come to court at some point in 48 hours. At that particular time, your lawyer may not have enough time. PDs and shit goes so fast. You know, it's just what happened. But when you come to court, is your time to be listening to the charges, listening to what's going on. You still are not saying anything. You don't say anything. You let the lawyer then do their thing, and then you're going to have to hang to get bailed. And because I'm going to tell you something. It is much better to spend that week or that 10 days or whatever it is there than to get hung up saying some shit. And now we're looking at a case that's on you.
Right.
It is much better.
Wow.
Oh, it right. is good. Much, much
but
better.
Let me hit you again. Let me play devil's advocate again.
Oh, and so I'll tell you just
I
to
want
say,
my lawyer. Okay, fine. Yes. What's your lawyer? What's his phone number or her phone?
They don't have they have no right to know. They have no there's no see, duty for them to know.
Do they I know Brother Walter is like smiling. Because he knows that's what the shit they do.
Oh, yeah.
And as I dove in, Brother Keith, I know what Brother what Reverend Philippe was alluding to is they prey on our ignorance.
Right.
And they start prying you. You want to go home, give you the bag of chips, and you don't know the law. Now, with you, my brother, everything that you just said is what we immediately start learning and teaching ourselves. Because I too should have been that athlete, but wasn't nobody pushing me like they pushed you. And I'm feeling all that love when you was running that, Bobby, because I should have went to the NFL. I had that kind of talent, you see. So as soon as I got in prison, oh boy, I done messed up. So I went and studied the Fourth Amendment. And this is why I asked the brother to do the show. You get one shot to say something, Brother Keith, and you said it. You said it. And why did you pull me over? And that's it. And if they do not give you a justifiable reason, legally speaking, you have the legal right to even walk away because they cannot detain you without probable cause or reasonable suspicion. Got
and
it?
That's why, but that's why you say, am I free to go, though?
Right. Am I free to go? Let me put that in the chat.
And here's the main point that I'm making with you, though, Brother Keith. You know the law. I have every right to ask that. Now, I'm not going to walk away because if they don't give, because they got to give me a reason. And once they give me that reason, whatever they say, the next thing I'm going to say is I want my attorney. Now, they're not bound by law to give you your Miranda. Am I right about that?
Or give you a reason why they stopped you. See, okay. That's the misnomer. They don't have to tell you why they stopped you.
Absolutely.
That's why you have to set the parameter by saying, can I just go?
Now, one more time. Now, I want to roll back because we're teaching the masses out there that don't know about this stuff. And God bless you, Philippe. I'm glad you put this 360 together because this is a powerful 360.
You hear what I'm saying?
No question. And then you got me and Greg over here that went all the way in. And those are the elements of nature: earth, wind, fire, water, northeast, southwest, hot, wet, cold, dry. Those are the elements of the planet: spring, summer, fall, winter. We have a dynamic energy here. But back to your point, Brother Keith, you are dead right. But again, to those of us that are out there committing crime, don't start screaming about you can't do this to me. I didn't do nothing wrong. Why are you talking to me like that? No, you get one shot, my brother. Why did you pull me over? Now, legally, I'm not going anywhere because I done invoked my fifth next. I want my attorney. They can't touch you no more.
That's right.
Like when I'm listening to you, though, Keith, it was like sort of like Walter. I didn't find out about my Fourth Amendment rights until I got locked up and everything like that. Because one, they do that purposely. They're not teaching us that stuff.
That's purposely. Right.
And I didn't know that so many times when I was still on the block, you know, before I started blowing up and had different traps and stuff. When we were just, you know, young kids on the block, I didn't know time and time again that my Fourth Amendment rights were being violated while they would just pull up on us and they say, hey, come here and all of that. Right. We didn't know We didn't know that they were illegally detaining us. We didn't know that they were doing it. Right. And we have to teach our young brothers and sisters because, see, like, we get a lot in my generation and other generations, we got a lot of people in the system that should not be there just because they're in the wrong situation did not know their rights. Yes. You know,
let me also add this, Brother Keith, and then we can come back to you because this is exceptionally powerful and we want to maximize your time that you have with us. So family, if you have not read The New Jim Crow, you have to understand what's going on. In the 80s, police didn't have jobs. There was no jobs and a future in law enforcement because everybody was doing well or better than well. There was crime, but there was no mass incarceration. And so there was no reason to really go into law enforcement because there was not any crime at that level. So what the government did is where there is not a problem, create one. All right. Now I've had, and I should have posted this, but I have two sacred interviews with Freeway Ricky Ross. And Freeway broke it down as to what happened. when Reagan got into office and they developed, and then this is a layered effect. You've got Biden, who wrote the laws. Right. You've got Kamala Harris, who is following the laws, because I know a brother here who sat before Kamala and got 3 years.
That's right, San Francisco.
You've got Clinton, who came in and made it even stronger and invoked that Three Strikes Act. Yep. And so now you look at, if you looked at the chart, it went from here, flat line, to a straight line up. Mm-hmm. Mass incarceration like no other. Now, crack cocaine, manufactured and sponsored by our wonderful U.S. government.
CIA,
using
baby.
Freeway Ricky Ross as the scapegoat. Yep. To bring it in, because he mastered the game. As Greg said, as Walter said, when you run a drug operation, when you're a street soldier, when you're out here making that money on the streets, you're really a CEO. You're just doing it, if you will, illegitimately, but you're just trying to eat. Now, we know, watching my show and watching the experts on that show, this is called axiology, your environment, your zip code. Right. You're born into it. You don't know any better. You don't know any different. You are just trying to survive. There's no jobs. What if I can't get an education? What if I don't have time to get an education to get a job? What do I have to do to eat right now? My mama's sick. I got to buy diapers for my kids. I'm a baby daddy or a baby mama. What do I do? I've got to be out here selling these rocks and doing what I got to do and dealing with the race soldiers. We got street soldiers and we got race soldiers. Okay. Mm-hmm. So now we're looking at a situation, family, where they created the prison industrial system, and they created a trillion dollar industry.
Right.
As a result of that, well, where are we going to go and fund it? Let's go to the poorest communities.
Right.
And say we are going to have law and order. And 99%, if you watch it, of all of these Beckys and Karens who are talking about, and Bobs and Bills who are talking about, we don't want these black people in our block. Y'all don't live with us any damn way. We don't go to your goddamn neighborhood. So you're talking about something that's not even your experience. But they, oh, we're the afraid white people. Yeah. And we've got to get this crime under and the drug stuff. We don't want crack coming here. Bitch, crack ain't coming there because maybe your son has crack, but black people ain't coming to your house smoking crack. So this is the illusion. So they created an industry to lock us up. And that was multiplicable. Of course, we can go into, you know, changing the population, getting out the fathers so that they can't vote and they can't multiply. That's a whole nother thing. What we're trying to do tonight is we're trying to give you, your kids, your family members, your loved ones, the tools to survive and to live. And I wanted Walter to come on. I'm so glad he reached back out to me. I wanted Greg to come on because I wanted you to see both sides of the fence and have an understanding of nothing is wrong with any of us. This is the shit that is happening to us, and it's deliberate. And so we have to learn to fight fire with fire, increase our intelligence. And that's why Walter has probably been on every corner of this continent speaking and preaching and teaching as a motivational speaker to save as many lives as possible. But I think what we have tonight with this, with Keith on here, we've got both sides. And when the cop tells you to do something, mm-hmm. God damn it, do it and go home. Go home and live.
You gotta remember.
Even though Philando Castile, our shit, rest in power, he complied. But still, that's a rarity, that's the minority, not the majority. So some of us are dead right now just because we were talking back to the police. If Walter had turned around, flinched, or done anything, it would just be me, Greg, and Keith on this program tonight.
That's right.
And you know, you make a good point, but you got to remember too, when we're dealing with this society too, they make sure that they show many of the people who complied and get killed to put the fear into us. So, you know, because we're already suffering. We're already suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder in our neighborhood. We're already suffering from fear of police because, you know what I'm saying, how many kids have been traumatized from seeing the police kicking the doors illegally, drag their parents out, and stuff like that. So it's mm-hmm. already, you know, like when we're talking about the axiology and everything like that, and the epigenetic tags and everything like that, the trauma is already there. So we already got a stacked deck. So we got a whole new generation that, you know, ain't buying into. If I comply, I can go home. They, you know what I'm saying? And we have to educate them on the right ways to do things so that you can go home. You know, because right. a lot of them, like, we're right. not going home even if I comply. I got too much evidence, even though it might be isolated incidents. Now, I ain't talking about the, you know, it's a true thing.
But to push back what you're saying, though, Greg, or not to push back, but to agree with what you're saying, Brother Greg, what Walter has taught me is that you just have to at some point admit, okay, I'm doing dirt out here in these fucking streets.
Right.
I've got drugs on me. Okay. I'm a fucking criminal. I robbed some shit. I did some shit. Okay, you got to come clean with that. You got to be saying, okay, I fucked up, but I'm going to comply. So I don't, even though you don't want to go to prison, you don't want to go to jail.
Right.
Okay, what the fuck it do for your Subaru? But here's the deal. You can end up with 1 year or you can end up with 20 years based upon how much you're going to talk and how you don't or do comply. So and these are the things. It's like you're going to go anyway. You might be in a situation where, yeah, you're going to go down anyway. But it might not be as bad as you think. Go ahead.
Right. And then going back to what brother to again augment my brother Keith as the attorney, because like you just said, in our minds, Brother Greg, we know what our dirt is. We know when they got us that they got us. But now we educating with this quadrum that we have here now to educate our brethren on what they must do to come and see Brother Keith. Because in my mind, I know that I'm dirty. In my mind, I know that I've done wrong. So I know enough in law to take the fourth and ask, why have you detained me? Then after that, I'm going to take my fifth. And then I'll call my attorney and I'll divulge all of that to him and let him work to get me up out of this situation.
And let me throw in. And this is going to show why I do what I do.
Take it out the ballpark.
Check this out. This is all an education, right? I had to learn how to sell dope. From somebody, right. I had to learn how to deal out there, and all I'm talking about is you got to learn how to be a good criminal by knowing what to do.
That's right.
You ain't a good criminal if you don't know your Fourth, Fifth, right. Fifth Amendment rights and how to that's exercise right. them. So mm-hmm. I always don't Genius. Judge. I don't judge Genius. My brothers. I go, mm-hmm. you know, look. Let me just hip you to something. If you're gonna be a good criminal, then you got to know how to act. And the way to act is under the law. Why? Because it's the law that's going to grip you. So it's the law that's going to free you. And that's mm-hmm. going to be knowing your Fourth Amendment. And I don't give a shit if it's 2-year-old, 3-year-old, your kid, mm-hmm. anybody should just say, am I free to go? Because it's a question to them.
That's right.
And they have to answer the question. Sometimes don't they get do it verbally. Sometimes mm-hmm. they don't do it verbally.
That's right.
But no matter what, after that is you want your lawyer. It seems so simple sometimes. Everybody like, but that's too easy.
Right.
That's easy to do. And I'm going, that's right. Because the law is easy to do. This is the easiest thing you'll do to save your life. Easiest thing to do to preserve your case. Because you don't ever fight your case on the street corner. When do they bring in the judge and everybody on the street corner?
They don't.
They never do that. So you're setting yourself up for the future. Mm-hmm. That you live as well as be in a best position to fight your case. I swear to God, look, I don't care if they pull you over in a car. I don't care mm-hmm. if they see you on a mountain pass. I don't mm-hmm. care if they pass you. However you encounter a cop, mm-hmm. if they say anything to you, like, good day, sir. Hey, may I talk to you? Your word is, am I free to go?
And let me say this, big brother, because this whole backdrop behind Brother Philippe is my lead in. With the military, brother. And this is one, again, that I'm going to probably get hit on the chin with because I'm going to call it like it should have been called. I'm glad that brother didn't get nothing done to him, to hurt yeah. him. I'm glad they didn't, you know, rake him across the ground and beat him up. But here's what the media did. The brother kept saying, I represent the youth, the military. Well, brother, no. They pulled you over because you didn't have a tag, which by law, they had the right to do that. And then you got your one shot, my brother. You got your one shot. You understand me? To ask, why did you pull me over? Now, with all due respect, after having studied law in prison as a former felon, see, because God blessedly, I'm glad that brother lived the life that you live, Keith. I'm glad he didn't put himself in the position that me and Greg put ourselves in. So for them to flash this all over the nation and show the brother keep being a little bit argumentative because he served this country. My dad served this country. I lost two uncles that served this country. And I had three other aunties that served this country. Altogether, seven of us served this country. And one thing I know about coming from a military family, shut the hell up. Even though you got on this nice uniform and you represent this country, right, brother, let them run their 50 on you and you drive on down the street. Then we would have never heard nothing about his story. But because that brother got tanked up because he's a good brother, and I'm not taking nothing away from him. But this gives us the perfect opportunity to go all the way in on this, because they should interview some of us that we could come and even say, I'm glad that brother served in this country. I kind of wish that I had served the country instead of going to the penitentiary. But when they pulled you over and said, because you didn't have a tag and the officer was wrong, don't get it wrong or get it twisted. But another brother would have got shot if he didn't have that uniform on. And in the military, you cannot, they do not let underlings, they do not let privates, when you're a lieutenant with that high rank, ain't no underling gonna talk back to that lieutenant in the military. And we needed that brother to exemplify that, but had he done so, he wouldn't have been in the situation for us now to be teaching the way that we're teaching. And finally on that piece, I'd rather be tried by 12 than to be carried by 6. Yes.
Say it. Now hold on. Hold on. Here's TW. She says, officer says, where are you headed to? This is Keith. Am I free to go? First thing you say, invoke the fifth. Invoke the fourth. Second, if you are detained, I want my attorney. Now, watch this. The Jughead one says, I disagree, Donald G. Simmons. I don't know if somebody, Donald G. Simmons, is up there agreeing with us. Okay. He says, we do not comply with evil. We must stop being cowards and organize and defend ourselves. You are a fucking dead man walking. Okay? You are a motherfucking idiot, and you are going to die on these streets. Because if you do what the fuck you just said that we do, that's what they're, yes, they're cowards. Yes, they're evil. Yes, they're fucked up. But there's a way around that shit, and you circumvent it. And you go the fuck home. You don't sit up and say, oh, y'all evil. That's why many of us right now are in the fucking ground, or we're in prison, losing our fucking lives, dying of old age in prison. And by the time we get out, we ain't good for shit. So that, I wanted to show the dichotomy. I love you. I love you, Jughead. I don't know you, but I have to, I got to love you. I'm a minister. I've seen what I know some shit. I've gone through some shit. My brothers have gone through some shit. And we have, this is the stupid nonsense we have to stop. Okay, go ahead.
I want to go somewhere, the step after all of that. Cause see, like I say, I didn't learn about my rights until, you know what I'm saying? After, you know, after being and all that. Then I understand the game that they play in the justice system now. Because when I got locked up, when they finally got me downtown and I invoked my Fifth Amendment right when I got caught with that half a kilo, they left me over in the old part of the jail, you know, for hours, you know what I mean, hoping that they could break me. Then came the other part of the system where they try to screw us over the most, the cash bail, where they set the bail so damn high where you cannot bond out. I remember sitting down there, man. You would have thought I killed a Kennedy or somebody, man. $250,000 bond. Not, and this wasn't even when I got caught with a half a kilo. You know what I'm saying? But they knew I had enough money. They said, well, we're not going to take your money. You need a house to go with it. And my mom wasn't going to put up my house and all that stuff, you know, all that goods. I mean, her house to go with the cash. But the second time when I got caught with the weapons and the disability, they knew that I could afford to get out, and they set that bond so damn high, the cash bond, at $250,000. And I'm like, so they try to make, you know, these are the games that, you know, we have to educate our people on, that they're going to sit there, because their whole game is, if you come in and you say you're invoking your fifth right, you get with your lawyer, they want to break you because they want to keep you on that steel and cement so long that you finally take the plea bargain that they give you so that they can get that, you know, at the end of the day, they just want the conviction, you know.
And let me throw this out. Look at here. We're talking about power, right?
Right.
And the guy was saying that, you know, I'm going to tell him right then and there. Leave me alone.
No,
right?
No, he just, here he is again. Let's, you know, I don't normally do these type of shows where I debate with the audience because, you know, shit, I bring the best minds in the world on the platform. And somebody also said something about We are behind enemy lines. People obviously don't pay attention to the compensatory code given to Neely Fuller. Neely Fuller ain't gonna bail your bitch ass out. Baba Kaba ain't coming to fucking pay your bail. Professor James Smalls, Rev Shock ain't gonna do shit for you. You need to do what the fuck the lawyer is telling you to do and what Walter Smith and Greg Smith is telling you to do so that your bitch ass can live. This is real, family. I'm not here to pussyfoot around with you, sugarcoat this shit with you, okay? We can watch all the scholars you can, but a lot of y'all going to be reading about the scholars in prison, okay? Or dead. Or you might end up not dead or in prison. You might be mutilated by the cops. You might be more injured by the cop. Well, you ain't walking. You ain't talking. You in a wheelchair because of the shit. This is real. So all of this shit about Neely Fuller and that's for people when your ass is out and you free. Okay? Now, this brother is saying, Philippe Matthews, my FBA, and I love you too, foundational black African brother. He says, I am incorrect. Malcolm X, Carlos Cook, Fred Hampton, Hall of Dead taught us this. They cannot lock up 45 million warriors. You are incorrect, Philippe, my brother.
If they can't lock us up, how many brothers are incarcerated now?
Wait a minute. If it was 45 million, if they had done what I said, they would 30 million would have never been locked up. You see what I mean? What I'm coming from is this power.
4 million power are in prison. In the mind. 7.5 million are out as felons. Look at the numbers. Yes, they can.
but here we go. We got to take, we call it a case-by-case basis, right? Sure. And what is power? Power is knowing more than the other person. If I know more than you, then I'm more powerful than you.
Right.
Now, if I use my words and my thoughts and it brings a different outcome than just being mad and upset and throwing shit out there, then I'm showing I'm ignorant to them, you see? Mm-hmm. And when I tell you is powerful, it's so powerful, you will watch the cops' attitude change. Mm-hmm. You will watch and they will know that you know something more than what the average
They'll amp up and try to really say, is he really that smart? And then at some point, they're going to change their
You're that smart, though. They know that by just the words that you say. Yep. Because that you're smart enough to shut the fuck up when it comes time to talking about what you're doing.
Right.
See, realize cops, they got the up on you. When they grab you, I don't know they saw me down the street. Let's look at Mike Brown, right? The cop came up, right, and jammed him up, right? He's walking along. Now, Brown may not have known that he went down there and saw a videotape and all that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. So when he's talking to Brown, all Brown had to do was say what? Hey, am I free to keep on walking? See, and the cop would have said what? No, because I'm investigating some shit. I don't give a shit what he knows, but I know he said no. Therefore, I know, okay, then let me shut the fuck up because you know some shit that I don't know, and I'm going to be smarter than you and just say, come on, cop, take me in then. Let's go, cop. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I live and I fight my case because I haven't said shit about a robbery. I haven't acted any different way. And when I go to court and I fight that case, I'm going to ask, is it really a robbery or did the brother know that this guy was behind him? Because we don't have any other words from him or anybody else to say that anything else happened.
Let me have a mic drop moment, my brother Keith. This brother, I love you, Jughead, and I'm appreciating your spirit. But also, I want you to understand, like, we just talked about Malcolm X, Fred Hampton, Carlos Cooks. Yep, yes. Got all of that. They're dead. But here's the difference between Malcolm, Fred, Carlos, and all the people that's on this panel right now. George Floyd, Oscar Grant, Tamir Rice all did not say, am I free to go?
Right.
None of them.
And I want to add, too.
None of them. And if they had said, am I free to go, we might not know their names today.
Well, the cop can only say no. And once they say no, you're going downtown. You're going in. So that's when you protect yourself with armor by saying, then you're not getting a fucking word out of me.
And here's what I want to show to Brother Jughead. This is the most powerful weapon you can have. And Brother Jughead, if you got the link to 45 million warriors, just introduce me to 10 of them because I'm going to leave my contact information when I get off the phone. This is more powerful. Then you run in your mouth when the police pull up on you, brother, because they have a license to kill you. And it's always good when we play Monday morning coach. George Floyd, I hurt to my heart to see what they did to that brother. all that brother, and he's a big brother. And I'm gonna demonstrate and show you what happens when you're a big black man. And they try to put them cuffs on you in the back like that.
Right.
Just like that. So, brother Jughead, I'm a big black man. And that's what they said when they had me on the ground. Look at the arms on this nigga. They got a license to kill you, Jughead. Your game sounds good on here, my brother. So I'm going to give you my contact stuff, and I look forward to hearing from you, gangster, because I want to meet 10 of them 45 million you got so they can help me know what to do when the war breaks out and we got to protect our women, our babies, and the rest of our families. But when you get pulled over by them police and they got a license to kill you, look, you comply.
And look at George Floyd. Remember, minutes before they took him out and put him on the ground, they were just trying to get him in the car.
Right.
He didn't want to get
resisting.
In the car.
Resisting.
Right.
I want to hit on the point where, he was talking about the organization, organized. Part of organizing, part of true organizing is knowing everybody's role, because we got to, you know, you cannot organize with just soldiers. You know what I'm saying? Because that's not the way government is ran. You know, and street government has the same thing. You got your soldiers, you got your, you know, your concierge. You got to have everybody play their role. So when we're talking about, you know, organizing 45 million brothers and sisters out there organized, we got to have people in their role. So if part of organizing is taking the brother Keith Statens and following the directions that they give him, you know what I mean? Because they know the law. They've taken the time to, like, you know what I'm saying, to learn their craft. So you go to somebody who know their craft and follow that way. Like, you know, like you were saying earlier, the street code, you know, the street code that I played out there, I knew my role. I knew where I stood at. I knew what I had to do. You know what I mean? It's the same when we're playing in this same arena. Listen, man. People don't realize this until they come out the streets and get in here. Politics is just like the dope game, except where they change clothes. You are no longer wearing jeans and soft shoes. You're wearing clothes like what you got on. And you better know what you're doing if you want to go home at the end of the day. I'd rather be alive than in prison, where I have a chance to, you know, appeal and get out.
That's right.
Than being dead because I want to prove my point to some racist ass cop. Who already is mad because they done caught me with more money than I'm making a year. Right. They already see that I'm outsmarting them because, see, like, every time they would raid us, man, they would never find the money. They would get a little bit of drugs, but they would never. The biggest raid, I mean, look, when they caught me with the half a kilo, the first thing they asked me was, where the guns? Because they were hoping to tie me up with the feds, right? Now, the next time when they started running up in my traps when I came home and we started back doing it, We were running things the way we were organized. There go that word again, organization. The way we were organized, when they would raid our spots, they might find like 20 caps of boy, 20 caps of girl, and at the most $300. Because they see the foot traffic all day, and they thinking that they're going to run in this spot and find hundreds of thousands. But we were being organized. So everybody needs to know their role. And part of knowing our role is to follow what the lawyers tell us. That's what we paid them for. That's what we.
If you're going to do crime, know how to be good at it. That's all I'm saying.
That's all I'm saying.
Know the fucking law. Know that if you're going to meet with an attorney, do what they tell you to do beforehand, so you get a better chance of having to improve your lot. But wait a minute. Carlette.
Yes, I was going to say. There's your drop.
Said, I guess that's a she. I asked, am I free to go? They let me go here in Sacramento. And shut up, capital letters, three exclamation points. Keith is the GOAT. Now, here's the thing.
It works.
Thank you for that, Carlette, because we need to have some levels of confirmation to understand what is going on. Now, I know Brother Jughead said Tamir Rice didn't get a chance to say, am I free to go? Yes. They put that on there to polarize, to show you and to make you weak and make you think that it doesn't matter. That this is the same thing that they did with George Floyd and Rodney King and all of that. They do that. That's a scare tactic. And yes, but when you have an understanding of how this goes every single day, because 90% of us will never be on the national news, because if we are on the national news, chances are we're dead.
That's right.
So understand, we're talking about percentages of staying alive. Now watch this. I had Reverend Dr. Ray Higgins on the show and Brother D. Ray. I can't think of D. Ray's last name, but he is a law enforcement, a sheriff as well. He's a Dr. D. Ray now. Ray Higgins was a police officer in Ohio. He's a peace officer and was working with the trauma units and what have you in Ohio. This is the deal. Law enforcement is the only industry in America where you can have a GED or a high school diploma. And in 6 fucking years after being a rookie, make $250,000 in certain areas and parts of the state. You are dealing with someone that is just as ignorant as your ass is, but they have a badge and a gun now.
Right.
Their self-esteem is low or vacant, just like yours. Many people go into law enforcement for the power and for the money, because they can't go to school and get an education or college. And some just don't want to do it, even if they had the opportunity. It's a short stick. They'll say, hey, I'll deal with the trauma. This is why you don't see good cops, if there is such a thing, talking about bad cops. They can't. They can't. Stop it. This is dumb shit that we're having these conversations about. This is about a group of people who have been marginalized and minimized, white, black, Asian, whatever community they're coming from. They do not have an education. They're just as dumb as all of us in the streets. And so they're going to talk to you any kind of way. There's not a cop show I've seen where they don't call you a motherfucker, a nigga, shut the fuck up and talk down to you and make you feel like you're less than. Why? Because they are less than, but they got that badge. They passed that fucking test. Some of them was able to run their fat asses around for 2 minutes or whatever the compliance is, and they got that damn badge. And now, oh, I feel so good. I used to work out with a brother at the YMCA in Chicago. This brother was brilliant, mathematician. I said, brother, why do you want to be a cop? He says, man, I want to have a license to shoot people. Mm-hmm. That's it. That was it. You have to understand, when you come from a neighborhood and a block of uneducated people, you come from a family of alcoholics, people who are struggling and suffering, you want out. And there is nowhere you can go where you can be, pardon my French, my version. I'm a PhD candidate. I dropped out of the sixth grade. So I understand getting my GED. I was just as stupid dropped in the sixth grade as I was when I got my GED. I didn't know shit because I'm on the block. I'm a nigga out here in these streets. Yeah. I didn't have self-esteem. I had vacant esteem. Had I have known that I could, well, no, I wouldn't have done that. But had I known that I could have made $250,000 being a cop and probably retire as a millionaire, I might have looked at that. But I couldn't, because I don't like to say it publicly, but I really don't like law enforcement. But nonetheless, so I couldn't be on that side. But this is the thing that you're up against, and y'all don't know this shit. Y'all think that these people are well-educated and well, no, they just are reading what they've been taught to do. They are following the law. They are told what to do. They are race soldiers.
And most of them don't even know the law.
They don't even fucking know the law.
They don't even, they enforcing the law that they do not even know.
A lot of them,
see, this is the importance. This is the importance of having a lawyer or educating yourself on your rights and the things you do. Because see, I had so much evidence since, I mean, I had so much stuff suppressed because of what I did learn. And I, you know what I'm saying? When we got there, they couldn't even take that into court. You know, like only thing that they had before I took my plea, right, was my co-defendant's 3-page statement because of everything that I did up to that point. And you know what I'm saying? He wrote this 3-page statement and everything. And my lawyer said, we're going to eat their ass for lunch in court because we're going to trial. Only thing that made me take the plea was 2 weeks before trial date, they came up with new evidence. And what it was I had one of these devices right here. Now, look, this is what got me. They went in and they finally got the subpoena from, you know what I'm saying, from the carrier, and they got all of my messages. They told my lawyer that, you know, well, we got them on voice, you know what I'm saying? He said, that's a lie, Greg, because if they did, they would have to present me the CD with everything on. But what they did have was all the transmissions from the text messages. Me and my people that I'm dealing with on California, we sending text messages. And like, if I listened to my partner that day, I would have left the phone. But I didn't. I didn't leave the phone because I'm thinking I'm going to have communication once I did what I needed to do. Yeah. I had a phone for that, but I didn't take it. So, like, a lot of things got thrown out by me listening to my lawyer and following him. One good point that you said earlier, and I'm going to yield after that. To be a good criminal, you have to understand what's going on. And after I got clean and everything like that, somebody busted my bubble, you know what I'm saying? Because, you know, like, I came out the streets. I still had some money. I still had some material things and all of that stuff. And my dude, I was about 2 years clean and doing all of this stuff and everything. And he said, at the end, you weren't even a good criminal. I'm like thinking like, shit, I got material things. What the hell are you talking about? He said, good criminals don't go to jail. End of story.
Facts.
Oh, 100%. And the cell phone thing, we got brothers today who pull licks and do things and then broadcast it on social media.
Don't go live.
Or you go do some shit and you got your phone on.
Right.
Because now I can GPS everywhere you went.
Right.
It is the most stupidest thing to have your phone on if you're going to do something.
And because there's the GPS, now I can go to your mother, your father, and have them come down and say, hey, just talk to us. Now I can make them say some shit that incriminates them. I can take the whole fucking family.
That's why everybody got to know the rules. Everybody got to know the rule. The rule is shut the fuck up. Period.
And I cannot let Jughead go because, you know, he mentioned the B-45 warrior. Here's the thing. Black people only represent less than 13% of the national population. Ooh, but yet I live in Columbus, Ohio, where blacks represent 25% of the population. But our police force is 95% white.
Right.
Yeah. So why don't you take that army of yours of 45 million and tell them to become police and police our communities? Then we don't have to worry about white people killing us all the time. Right. And then when they become part of the community, hopefully we'll respect them more like they will respect us more. Why don't we take that army and do that and get them out of our community? Because I have a major problem with that. Now you give them the power to kill us because they have a license to kill you. Yes. And if you have not laid down on the ground with a gun up against your head, my brother, then you can talk all that gangster stuff that you're putting down. But take that army of yours and have them come into our communities and police our community. And then I don't want us to veer too far away because, again, I'm still a good person. I did not keep beating myself up in prison for the mistakes I made. I come from a good family. I come from a good background. I'm a good person doing good now. I got a lot of people make a lot of good money off the successful businesses that I run. And I'm all over this whole country. And I see there are Irish communities, Italian communities, German communities, and British communities. You do not see black police officers policing them white communities.
Right.
So take that army of yours, my brother, and have them do what that army that you say is trained up to do. Have them come into our communities. And if the government don't want to pay them, then they should do it for free anyway. And if they do it for free, we got enough rappers and entertainers and classism.
That's right.
Black people that make all this money that they could come and pay these same people to come into our communities and take good care of our communities. So let's put all that stuff into perspective. And I'm still waiting on your call. My number is 614-570-1906. 614-570-1906.
Philippe, may I drop the mic?
My man, this is why I love you, right, Walter? Come on now.
Thank you.
Drop the mic. Check this out. What you guys just said is the new manifesto, okay? You're right. We're all right. We are all right because, number one, if we do not gang together to do things against the powers that be, then we will lose.
That's
when
right.
We were able to gain things, it was because we did it together. So what we did was we don't kill each other. We don't bash each other. We take care of each other. We educate our children.
That's
and we
right.
buy black. You see, when we do that, that's Boom. What angers the white man and want to come after us because they want what we got. They've always wanted what we got. So we have to do such things because we can't expect them to change to accept us. It has been so many years where we want to say, hey, look what we can do. But that ain't working. It never did work. And they knew it didn't. And so now we have to take control of our own. then you're right. If we got an army of people, then let's use our army of people. But we use it under the law to use it against them, because they use the law to hold us down. And
that's
and
right.
They can change tomorrow. You don't think 2 years from now you get somebody as a president and they don't pass a goddamn law that says, well, they can enslave us again?
Oh, see, come on,
we'd
man.
Be fools to believe that that can't happen.
That's
and
right.
We have to take
man.
Control of the balls, squeeze them motherfuckers to where we now have control of them.
See, I mean, that's why I got one fighting for me. I don't know what y'all got. Hey. I don't know who y'all got in all the other states, but here in California, this is the dude that I want to have, because he understands the ground game.
And it goes back
he
to
understands the ground game. Right. But let me give you this. Hold on, Brother Greg. Let me give you this. Now, I'm going to give you what I have learned from one of the greatest trauma experts in the world, Resmaa Menakem. His book is My Grandmother's Hands. Now, his brother is law enforcement. I forgot what level he's at. He might be retired or might be still in. I don't know. But in the book, he talks about white trauma, black trauma, and blue trauma, policing. Let me walk this. I was invited to speak on with a retired a law enforcement person on his podcast. And I explained something to him. Now, in law enforcement, all levels, as we all hear, it is the most stressful industry you could ever be in, because the human body is not supposed to see what law enforcement sees. Babies with their heads blown off, people with their guts hanging out, stab wounds, gunshot wounds, people who've been sitting up decaying, smelling, and all of this. It's the worst. That's the cost and the price you pay to be a rookie. You have now we talk about the epigenetics and the trauma imprints of black people. Let's talk about the trauma imprints of law enforcement. So now law enforcement is dealing with trauma on a daily basis, but they have nowhere to go to debrief and decolonize from that or metabolize, if you will, that trauma. They have to have the blue code of silence. They can't go to the community for help because they can't appear weak. So what do? They go home and they beat their wives, their kids, they drink. They are fucked up, many of them. It's the highest industry of suicide, and because they have nowhere to go. Now the cop pulls you over, you ain't got a goddamn clue what that cop just went through. You don't know what they're carrying, you don't know what beef they have, you don't know what chip they have on their shoulder. Their partner might have just got killed, their parents or family or whatever, their wife might be fucking them, fucking some other cop and leaving them and going whatever. They're going through fucking hell. And you are going to mouth off at them. They're ready to shoot you. They don't need right. a reason, but they're just ready to pop off. They're looking for a stupid, dumb nigga to say the wrong thing that they can jack up. They're waiting for us. And you don't understand that trauma that is embedded in their bodies, they blow that shit through you.
Yes.
They blow their trauma through you. They can't arrest each other. They can't beat each other. They can't shoot each other, but they can you. And so you have to be smart. You have to be smarter than all of them and understand, just as nothing is wrong with us, something happened to us. Well, look at the trauma that's happening to them. And I'm not defending cops. I'm not defending white people, but trauma is trauma. And if you come from trauma, you have to blow that trauma out some way. Law enforcement is a great way to be able to do that. How many people have you blow up on because you had a bad goddamn day? Right. You just don't feel right. Yeah. Now, imagine if you had the license to kill or simply That's take right. somebody's freedom away.
That's right.
Every fucking day. Every fucking day, all day. Here's the difference. When you go to war, now I'm talking to my military vets. Thank you for your service, my brother. When you go overseas or wherever you go, you're in theater for a moment, but it ain't every day. At some point you get to come home, and that means you have PTSD post.
Right.
That's the post. Debrief.
Right.
You get debriefed, but you have post. The sympathetic nervous system starts to kick in. You're having nightmares, hot sweats, PTSD, all of these symptoms, because it's post. What happens if you do that shit every goddamn day? There is no post. So just like we are dealing with racial battle fatigue, when Dr. Joy DeGruy talks about post-slave syndrome, mm-hmm. that's post. We're carrying it with us, and it's a drama and a trauma that we carry that's with right. us. But racial battle fatigue, that's every fucking day, all day, every day. When a cop comes home, they don't have time to debrief. They gotta fucking, they gotta eat, fuck, and go back out there the next day. Maybe play with the kids, kick the goddamn dog, and go back out there and that shit every fucking day. It is never post. So imagine all of that shit built up. And they can't go, here's the other thing that some people don't understand and realize. They can't, even if they go and talk to a psychologist or talk to a minister, if they are not trained in trauma, it ain't shit a damn psychologist or a minister can do for that person, because trauma is stored in the body, not in the head. So you can't positively, mentally attitude your ass back out of trauma when you just saw somebody get killed. And even though you might not have killed them, but that shit is in you. When you have to go home and deal with a wife that's fucking somebody else, or not fucking you, or is on drugs, or is an alcoholic, or and they got family members, you never get to escape the trauma. It builds and builds, and you develop a Derek Chauvin.
Now, piggyback on that, now you got that set of trauma, the blue trauma. Now you got these street soldiers who are living this stuff that they don't have a chance to debrief. And now they got a whole nother set of stress on them because they're worried about this dude who can't debrief. And you don't have, you know, you don't have a way to, you know, debrief either while you're out there in the streets. So now when you get, when trauma bumps up against each other,
yeah,
you know what I mean? It's nothing but an explosion ready to happen.
Whoever has the most trauma wins. They have the badge and the power win.
Whoever has the most power.
Yeah. So this is about this family. This is about playing chess. Don't fuck around with checkers.
Right. Right. You know, thinking 50 moves ahead.
Thank you.
And I've
gone through this personally. I know. I talk to cops. I know. I know what they're up against. I know what they're going through.
Yeah.
And sometimes every now and again, I get an opportunity to let, because they don't know what happened to them. They don't know why they're drinking. They don't know why they're angry. They don't know why they're suffering from PTSD. They don't know why they don't like black people. Some of them don't really actually know this. They don't know, but they just know that they have to follow the orders and follow the leaders. They know that when they go into the office, into the precinct, that the hierarchy treats them like shit. They talk down to them, make them feel like nothing but a piece of shit. Where do you go where you feel like you're somebody? Out here in the streets with ignorant ass people who don't know who they are and what they are. They don't know their first gods and goddesses having a spiritual experience. They ain't watching the Philippe Matthews show. They don't know this shit. You have to understand, family, what we're doing right now is kind of a luxury. You know, we got the opportunity to talk to people and what have you. There are people out here right now dying, don't know the shit that we know, that are not exposed to your YouTube channels that you have.
Yeah.
The cops are not looking at the YouTube channels that we're putting out and the content that we're putting out. They don't know Neely Fuller. They don't give a shit about Neely Fuller. And some of them, if they knew Neely Fuller and Baba Kaba, wouldn't give a shit anyway, because they're out there in the heat.
And that's why it's important what Brother Smith is doing, what I'm trying to do, what the other brothers and sisters are out here doing, going back into the communities and educating these people, like, you know, not just about how to stay alive, but also how to wake their minds up, because, you know, it's a ripple effect. If we're able to wake up one person, you know, like I'm still foot, you know, feet on the ground, you know, like one thing about it is, like, you know, I hear these people talk, you know, this organization, and like, and no disrespect to nobody. I the reason why I got into politics and shit, you know, because I ran for public office down here with a felony, with being a known drug dealer and all of that stuff. And I won 20% of the county. I ran for county commission, not city, you know what I'm saying? And won 20% of it, you know what I'm saying? In a red county on this platform that I ran on. And I get tired of these social media warriors who talk so much shit about what we should be doing, but they're not even going back into their own community, man.
Right.
You know, like, listen, man, and I don't mean no disrespect to nobody, because hopefully I provoke you enough to say, well, fuck that brother, he made me mad. Let me go out here and help somebody. You know, I get tired of that shit, man. We get so caught up on all this scholarship that we know what this person said, what that person said. At the end of the day, I love my elders and all that, but my motherfucking elders ain't going to keep me alive, and they ain't out there with me when I'm talking to these brothers, when I'm still having to go out here and talk to these brothers who are nervous, and then I got to earn their trust, because see, they still packing and they don't trust nobody. They don't trust nobody. They don't. I've been out the streets. Their parents might know me, but they don't know me. So where are you at? Why are you trying to organize when we doing this shit? I don't see a lot of these people right there with me when I'm going back into the DeSoto Baths, when I'm going back out there and talking, you know what I'm saying? When I'm going back out there, man, you know what I'm saying, and do that stuff, man. I don't see these brothers that be on this keyboard talking all this, what we should be doing. Look, one thing I learned, gangsters move in silence. So when I'm out there in the streets in the community and I'm still being that frontline soldier, I don't see all them loud mouth motherfuckers. Oh, let me stop me before I get...
Hey, and if I may, I want to, because I think it's a good time to start injecting, man, my book, Street Soldier from the Hood to the Good, written on a sixth grade level. We have to reach the middle school babies and work our way up, but it's also good for someone that's 86 that want to read it, because it's edutainment. And you got a lot of people all over the country talking about the Tulsa massacre. Well, I wrote about it, and when I published this book in 2016, won't nobody interview me, though, from a former felon perspective. And now I want to talk about fratricide, brothers killing brothers. The word fratricide is a French word. Frat means brotherly, side means to kill. Suicide, homicide, pesticide, infanticide, brothers killing brothers. The number one killer of another black man is another black man between the age of 16 and 34. So for a solution, because we don't offer up enough solutions. I watch people and study people on TV and on radio that talk about all our problems. They get all these influential people. They talk a good game, like Brother Greg just alluded to, but rarely does anybody have a tool. This is a tool. I've spoken in more than 2,000 schools, more than 2,000 prisons. I have reference letters out the wazoo. Why don't people interview me? I'll tell you why. Is America really trying to fix the problem? Because if it don't bleed, it don't lead. And as long as you got us out here in this racial turmoil, black people getting killed by white cops, we get all this hype all over the country, all over the world. They're not putting on the news that baby that just had a 4.25 GPA that went to college on an athletic scholarship. That don't make the news. And if it ain't Donald Trump, they don't make the news. So between Donald Trump and then all this other stuff that's going on out here, especially us killing each other, if we want to stop the problem, this is an excellent book, Brother Keith. I am a lawyer. I just did not go to school to get my degree like you went, big brother. I had to do mine on my own, because I'm the only person in this country, unless somebody proved me otherwise. I went to prison, sentenced 84 to 216 years. I was wrongfully convicted for raping three white women, sentenced 78 to 190 years. And with the help of Jerry Revish, the only person that believed in me, a true journalist, that's a pastor. But for the fact that one man believed in me, because I represented my damn self, because wouldn't no attorney touch my case? Because even these black attorneys at that time, and Brother Keith, I'm going to call you, but even then, wouldn't nobody touch my case because of post-traumatic stress syndrome, as Dr. Joy DeGruy Leary mentions. You see, because they done made it. And when America say a black man done raped a white woman, ain't nobody going to get behind that Negro. But one man believed in me, because there's not a person in this country that got a black hue that's supposed to be a Negro, that's supposed to be a media. Ain't none of these so-called leaders going to do what a Jerry Revish did for me. So I'm glad that I picked up a book, and it's all in here. If we want to stop
before losing... Where we get the book? Somebody asked. Book, Brown Honey, Brown Eyes Honey One says, how can we get your book, brother?
Okay, my name is, again, Walter D. Smith. That's my website, walterdsmith.com. And my Facebook page is Walter D. Smith. But then again, I'm going to say my phone number real, real slow. 614-570-1906. 614-570-1906. This is the solution right here. We do not read. I went into prison reading on a sixth grade level. I left on grade level 14. I've won 5 lawsuits since I've been out of prison and getting ready to file 5 more. I don't play. And I ain't been to these people's university like my wonderful brother Keith. I'm glad you did what did nobody make me do, my brother. So when I didn't have nobody else that would stand up behind me, only had one person and my mother. And by the way, the final thing that I'll say, and I hope to push this book some more, I laid down on that ground with that cop had that gun up on my head, because who gonna take care of my mother? the last 6 years of my mother's life that needed 24-hour care, died from dementia, and she was well, extremely well taken care of. And they said, put her in a home. Yes, she's going to be in a home, all right, because out of all the dirt that I did and went to the penitentiary, I got to get out of here, and I ain't going to keep beating myself up for having been born in America, didn't understand why I was going through the psychological pain as a big black man like Michael Brown in America. But I'm so glad that God gave me the courage, like my great-great-great-grandfather, who came across the Atlantic on the ship, because I would have been just like Jughead. They would have had to kill me because I'm a warrior. But no, right. My great-great-granddaddy said, no, I don't give a damn what they do to me. It's more important that the stuff that comes from my hips stay alive, so that I can have generations after me to have a baby, so that my great-great-great-great-grandson, Walter Smith, can get out here and save somebody else's baby. And I want the mothers that done lost a son to this violence out here from us killing each other. Please contact me, because you'll get a book for free.
Well, 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 as the church would say, amen, ashe, and so it is. That's what we do here, family. This is the thing. I'm trying to save lives. I'm trying to empower you, enlighten you, liberate you, educate you, and emancipate you. I am not your typical minister. You probably have gleaned that by now.
That's why you're my spiritual advisor.
That's right. So if you haven't figured it out by now, if this is your first time, I'm not going to Bible you. I'm not going to give you no bullshit. I'm not going to give you no foolishness. I'm coming with the truth, because this is going to save lives. It saved my life. We ain't nobody on this panel have not gone through shit. We have all gone through hell. That's why we're the experts on heaven, because we've gone through hell and we survived.
Yep.
And now it's time to share them shits. We got to share this with the community. We got to let them know. Again, shout out to my elders, shout out to my scholars, shout out to my ancestors. Of course we love you. Of course we respect you.
Yes.
But as I said, Baba Kaaba is not going to pay your bill. Okay? But Professor James Smalls, genius. He can't save you when that cop is saying, put your ass down on the ground. You make a move, I'll blow your fucking brains out. So you can quote Neely Fuller in that moment and see what the fuck happens. I'm just keeping it real, fam. Now, you can read Neely Fuller before you get a cop encounter and after, but if you don't do what Keith Staten is telling you to do, you're just going to be remembered somebody who followed the elders and the ancestors and yada, no Akhenaten and all of that, but you're going to be, we're going to come to see you rest in power. And that's just a fact in the way it is. You have to circumvent. Dr. Tommy J. Curry, one of our most brilliant philosophers, taught me and changed me. He says, Philippe, as long as white people exist, there will always be racism. Derek Bell, who was an attorney, taught us that you cannot fight racism. You have to circumvent it, meaning you have to go around it, meaning you have to be smarter than the race soldiers that are out here. You have to be educated and educate yourself. Back in the 60s, when we were looking at the civil rights movement, we're talking, my man Jughead was talking about Fred Hampton. Those brothers was in their 20s. Some of us are in our 60s and 70s, and we are dumb as hell, because they read, they knew the law, they knew how to fight power with the mind. They didn't fight racism, they circumvented it and changed the damn law so that we are the first, many of us my age, are the first to have our rights in this country.
Yep. And we still ain't got them all. We still don't got them all. Right.
Thank you. And we got to keep them. See, that's we got to keep them in exercise.
Wind us down, Brother Keith. Close us out.
Yeah, I got to run. Blessings to all of you. Blessings to everybody out there. Just remember, you know, you save your life, you save another. Okay? We stay alive and we can move faster. We can move on. He was right about the loins and things. You know, sometimes you got to shut the fuck up today so that you can say something tomorrow. And that's going to be the key. We got to keep on thinking about living on the next generation, creating the ripples in the water so that we're going to go, but somebody's coming up behind us. And that's how we will survive as a people and overcome. But I am so, so happy to always share with everybody, you know, and my whole thing is we got to survive as a people. It's no good if I do something, no good if we do it individually. We got to do it together, period. And I got to run, okay?
All right, my brother. Keith, I love you to pieces, my beloved. Thank you so much for sharing your life.
Get your number from, I'm going to get your number from Rev.
You can find me, Keith Staten. You can Google that.
I put the website in the chat, family, so you can get in contact with Keith Staten if you got questions. He will be able to educate you on where what the laws are in your state.
Right.
And maybe even be able to give you a recommendation for attorney in your city and state.
That's right.
So that you can go home and save your babies. Brother Greg,
I'm out.
You're out, Keith. Thank you, brother. Keith, last words.
You know, like one of the things that I want to leave people with is like, check this out. We are fighting a real battle out here. And I don't disagree with the brother Jughead when he said we need to organize, but there's a way of doing the organization. There's ways that we come in. You know, everybody wants to be a street soldier, but you know, you got to understand, man, soldiers have generals and generals have people that they, you know, that they answer to politicians. You know what I'm saying? And everything has a place in it. So we got to all learn our roles. We got to, first of all, understand if we're going, you know, like when I was in the military, we had a code of conduct that we acted by. We have to understand that we have to have the same thing out here. Nothing's wrong with saying that we need to organize and start fighting for our rights and taking our rights and all of that stuff back and everything like that. But you have to have a plan. You run out there in the streets without a plan, you're going to get your ass ran over every time. You keep on talking that stuff. And this is how we get brothers killed all the time, because we feed them with the warrior mentality, but we don't give them the weapons to fight with.
That's right.
The law is one of the things that we have to fight with. And some of the things that like I'm working on is like how to, you know what I'm saying, break down the preschool to prison population, pipeline, so I don't have to work with the brothers and sisters when they come home to teach them the things that, you know, we should have been getting taught early on in life. There's nothing wrong with having that warrior mentality, but we got to know how to put that energy in the right perspective, man.
And brother Jughead, he's saying he doesn't agree with me, and I appreciate that. But here's the other thing, brother Jughead. You're in the United Kingdom. This is America we're talking to right now. So the laws are different, and the shit is different here. Why don't you come here and live 40, 50 years here, and let's see, you might change your mind. It's a little different in the UK. Yeah, it's a little corrupt. It's fucked up. It's the same thing. But this is America, where white people were invented as a matter of law between 1664 and 1681. You have never lived the life of a nigga in these streets, in this country. And when you do, you might have a different understanding what happened to us, because ain't nothing wrong with us. Brother Walter Smith, please close us out.
Hey, again, my brother, I want to say that what my heart goes out to what that brother George Floyd went through. My heart hurt to see that brother go through what he went through. But I wrote about it in my book that I started writing in 1989. It's in the book, What We Should Do When Confronted by the Police. Also, what's in the book is I reduced the homicides in Columbus, Ohio to the lowest number the city has seen in 20 years because the mayor called and had a symposium on slowing down the homicides. I was called to be a part of that. I joined the mayor, didn't get no funding or anything. But the lowest number of homicides in 20 years. We're talking about homicides all over the nation now, but won't nobody call me? You would think that a journalist would call just to see if what I'm saying is true or not. It's in the book. So for our people that want to save our babies, we don't read. You don't have to buy the book, but if you buy it, because I'm okay. I run 3 very successful businesses. The book is a business, but I will send you an electronic book for free if you will make sure that your baby read it. Chances are 80% of the time babies do what they see us do. 70% of the time they would do exactly what they see us do. They will imitate, replicate, and emulate everything they see us do. So if we don't read, they ain't gonna read. If you can get the baby to read the book cover to cover, and darn it, if I could afford to give all of them a financial reward like I do my daughters, which is why they on honor roll in college, you understand me, I would. So honor them with something when they read the book so that we can save another baby. And again, I'm not hard to find. My name again is Walter D as in David Smith on both my website and Facebook. And my phone number is 614-570-1906, 614-570-1906. Philippe, I love you, man. Greg, I love you too, my brother, with all my heart. And thank you all for allowing us to share in this wonderful 360 degrees that was so prolific tonight.
Well, That's what they call a rap Wakanda forever. This is as good as it's get. Brother Greg, I'm going to implore on you, if you could. I know you have a podcast. I would love for you to have Brother Walter on your podcast, and let's establish a relationship. It is a damn shame that I just found out on this show, before this show, Walter said there has been no journalist interviewing him since the time he was on with me back in 2016. That's some bullshit. Okay, so now y'all gonna get ready to see Walter on a, y'all gonna get tired.
Especially with Walter's ass on this show.
Okay, because Walter is getting ready. We get ready to blow Walter up.
Yeah.
I need y'all to exalt this brother. I need y'all to understand that this brother is the truth. I need y'all to blow Greg Smith up. I need y'all to make Felons with the Future the unequivocal blueprint and model for killing the recidivism of our brothers going back into prison. Here's the thing. Just because it's in Ohio doesn't mean it doesn't apply to this entire country. So just because these brothers are in Ohio, you think because you in Baltimore or you in Los Angeles, it doesn't apply. Yes, it does. Because truth recognizes truth, game recognizes game. And these brothers have the information because they've been through the fire. That's why they know how to live and how to save lives. So I just want to thank both of you for your contribution. I'm sorry you had to go through what you went through, but I am elated that you have come out on the other side and to be able to give us who you are right now, because I love both of you emphatically. And thank you, my beloveds, for your contribution to us.
Real quick, Philippe, if anybody wants to reach me, they can at felonswithafuture@gmail.com, or they can go on our website, felonswithafuture.org. And if you want to model the same thing, I have no problem of allowing and giving people the same curriculum, because the curriculum was given to me, and we will help you implement it in your area, your city or whatever. So you can find me, like I said, at felonswithafuture at gmail.com, or go on our website, felonswithafuture.org.
Hotep community, we'll see you next time on the Philippe Matthews Show.